Hey, we made it. We're starting. Hey guys, Tom Thelen here. Time to start the live webinar for tonight. Really excited that you've joined us because we got a lot of great things to talk about. We've had a lot of good questions and topic ideas come in tonight. And I wanted to start out by telling you about something really cool that happened to me when I was speaking in New York just a couple weeks ago. I actually did 8 school assemblies in New York in 1 week. And one particular school I went to was called Beacon High School. Beacon High School in Beacon, New York. And giving a shout out in case any of you guys are on the line tonight. But as I entered the school, I remember walking up and something unique was happening. There was actually people standing at the door holding the door open. And I introduced myself. You know, all the kids were kind of entering. I was there at the very beginning of the day. And it turned out to be the school counselors. They had said, hey, we want to make an effort to get to know every kid, at least make ourselves known to every kid in our school. And I thought, wow, that really is a way to be the change. So shout outs to my friends at Beacon High School and other schools, other educators and administrators who are listening tonight. Think of that as a great idea, a way of connecting with your students. Principals could do this. Teachers, administrators, and counselors can do that same idea. Every day there's a chance to be the change. So tonight's session is going to be a fun session. I have a few questions that I picked out that did come in earlier today, but I mostly want to let you guys ask questions and let you guys set the topic. So you can email me. I actually see a couple of them are coming in as we speak. Or you can click into the chat box and we'll try to answer those live and we'll just have fun with it. Or maybe you don't even have a question. You just want to talk about how great the new Star Wars movie is or some such thing. So no spoilers though. You're not allowed to spoil it. I have seen it, but I'm not going to spoil it for anybody. So you could pick the topics. I'm feeling nice. It could be anything, but I'm hoping to hear some success stories from you guys tonight on what you're doing in your own life to make a difference in your school. And one of those stories that did come in earlier today was from Keegan in Suffern, New York. Keegan says, thanks so much for coming to our school, Tom, Suffern Middle School. We learned a lot and are still making the change. I made a friend with a new kid who seemed like he needed one. I will be the change. That's exactly what I'm talking about. That is being the change. So Keegan, you're the man. Way to go. I'm proud of you for what you did. It's hard to reach out and make a new friend when you don't know. Are they going to accept me? Are they going to like me? Am I going to feel weird when I ask them, you know, their name and that sort of thing? But you pushed past that and you were brave and you were the change. So awesome work. I had an awesome fall season. I actually spoke at over 50 school assemblies this fall. It was my busiest fall yet, ever since I've been doing this full time for the past 3+ years full time. And it was amazing to do that. Actually, we have a bunch of stuff coming up. Let me just look it up on my site really quick. If I'm coming to your area, tell your school counselors to come and preview my program while I'm in town and see if it's something they would want to book for their own school. We have coming up in January, Grand Blanc, Michigan, Saginaw, Michigan, Dearborn Heights, Michigan, Newport, Ritchie, Florida, Zephyr Hills, Florida, Portland, Michigan, Olivet, Michigan, Simi Valley, California, Charlevoix, Michigan, Beaver Island, Michigan, and West Lafayette, Indiana. So if any of those are near you, I hope you can come out if you're an educator and preview my program. Hope to bring that to your school someday. Before we go into some of the questions tonight, one of the things I wanted to talk about is the idea of what does it mean to be the change? And how do you become the change? I think the story that Keegan just told earlier when he sent that email was a fantastic example of what it's really all about. Because there is some fear that comes up when you know you need to do the right thing. There's always that little question mark in the back of your head, like, what if? And when you pause in that moment, that's when fear can overtake you. You have to push through it. You know, I like to think of being the change as something that has to be exercised. It's like a muscle. If you don't exercise it, it gets weaker and weaker. You know, my wife and I actually, this is a little embarrassing, but we watch some exercise videos and we do those together. And they're actually with Sean T, the guy with P90X and the exercise program, which is the one my wife recently bought. And he has all these great moves and dance moves and things that he teaches you to do. And as you start to work out those muscles, it kind of hurts, doesn't it? Because you're using muscles you had never used before that haven't been used in a long time. And I think a lot about one of the videos I watch where Sean and his exercise guys are, guys and gals are up on the stage. They're dancing and they're doing their routine and kickboxing and they're having fun, but then they're showing pictures of a live audience. So there's exercising people up front and then there's a live audience. And in this particular video, the live audience is sitting in a theater like this, you know, at their on their little cozy, you know, theater chairs. And they're just sitting there while Sean and his team are exercising. And I see a few of them kind of going like this, bobbing their head. And there's a few ladies brave enough to like do the hand motions, but none of them are standing up. And, you know, don't get me wrong. That's kind of the way that video was staged. It was sort of supposed to feel like a concert, I think. So those people were there to watch the exercise videos, kind of a little bit hokey. But when I thought about that, I said to myself, who do I want to be in my life? Do I want to be the guy up on the stage dancing with the team and really working out and really sweating and exercising my right to be the change in my world? Or do I want to be someone sitting in the stands? You know, so many kids in life, they sit the stands, they sit in the sidelines, and they wait for someone else to be the change. But not you guys. Those of you who are on the line tonight, I'm excited for you because I know that you're the kind of kids who are going to get out of the seats, get off the sidelines, get up on the stage, and actually be part of it. And what I mean by that is get up on the stage of your school. As you walk through the hallways of your school, as you sit in the classrooms and the lunchrooms and on the bus and on the football field at your school, that is the stage of your life. And every day you have an equal chance, a new chance, to be the change. I hope you'll exercise those muscles. Man, when you're first starting to work out, you're doing those push-ups, you're doing those jumping jacks, your muscles get sore, and it's a scary thing. And you might be tempted to stop. You might think it doesn't work, or I'm not seeing results. But you have to push through. You have to be the change. Don't sit the sidelines any longer. Well, let's get down to a couple of the questions that have come in tonight. And I'd love to go live with anybody who wants to enter some live chats into the chat box in group chat. Feel free. I do have some that have come in through email, but I think it'd be more fun to do a live chat. So be brave. Put your chat message up there. One of the messages that came in earlier tonight was actually from Jennifer. I'm not going to say her last name. I won't share your last name tonight if you post a question. But Jennifer, she asked a question I get a lot from parents, which is, what is one way to stop adult bullying? And so, Jennifer, I think you're referring to bullying like in the workplace. I just want to touch on that for a minute because 5 years ago or so, I was in a day job before I was able to start writing and speaking to schools. But I worked at a desk. I worked at a day job for a place called Acoustics by Design. And it was a great place. It was an acoustical engineering firm. There was one particular guy at that engineering firm who was known to really sort of throw his weight around. You know, that guy at your work. We all have that guy or that gal at our work who comes and asserts theirself not in a proper way, but in a domineering way. And that's what I mean by bullying. Bullying is when someone tries to dominate another person. Well, what happened to me is I let that guy eat my lunch for a long time. I don't mean my literal lunch, but I mean in my head and in my heart. His actions were consuming me. And when I would give that negative response, whatever it was really feeding into his power. And what I realized while I was there working that desk job is, Tom, you might get bullied, but remember, it's just like high school. Even when you were bullied in middle school, even when you were bullied in high school, you still had a choice to be a victim or to be victim-proof. And so for me, back then, I had to realize the kind of baggage and the kind of junk that came out of that guy's life and was placed into the other people's lives at our work It didn't have to be carried. The most important thing, I think, for adults is to realize how much power we have in our mind and hearts to not carry the baggage of other people. Now, listen, if that bullying is harassment or if it's intimidation, you obviously need to talk to someone at your work and get that figured out. That's wrong. But if it's just subtle social kind of stuff, there are no bullying police at your work. So you really have to set a boundary there in your heart where you say, their words don't have to get in that deep into my heart anymore. And that's how you become victim-proof even as an adult. So one other question I want to hit tonight came in from Shanae. Shanae in Texas says, where does bullying really come from and how can it be stopped? You know, that's a broad question, but I appreciate it because it allows me to talk a little bit broad on the topic, and then I hope to bring it in really tight to what I think you are asking. The broad question about bullying is, you know, where does it come from? Everybody is so quick to point the finger, aren't they? You know, is it video games or is it TV? Your kids are on social media way too much. You know, we give them these devices way too early and they don't know how to handle them. And maybe it's society and all of these different influences and bad music and whatever. But the thing that I think causes bullying the most, and I will give you a really clear answer on this, is the home environment of that student who's doing the hurting. You have to remember that hurting people will end up hurting other people. Hurt people hurt people. Now, I don't want that to sound trite or oversimplified, but when you see someone in your school who is being a bully, behind that kid almost always is a dysfunctional home. I'm not trying to point the fingers at parents or families, but what I'm saying is your family is the spot where you really let your hair down. And that's for better or for worse. And it just so happens that when you come home to a stressed out environment, a family that's full of anxiety and hurt and pain, guess what? All of that gets leached out into the lives of the children in that home. And those kids end up going to school and bringing that baggage with them into the school. So I'm not really trying to blame parents on bullying, but what I am saying is many times as a parent, we can accidentally transfer some of our own anxiety and our own stress into our kids. When we do that, they then are carrying more stress and more anxiety than they were ever meant to bear. And they literally bring that into school. We can't do that as parents. You know, about a year ago now, my wife and I realized that that would happen sometimes with our oldest daughter. And there are times where, you know, the punishment wouldn't fit the crime. And so sometimes, you know, our daughter has some listening issues. She's a very artsy-fartsy person, a lot like her parents, in fact. And we would say, how come you're not listening? And, you know, how come we keep hearing at school that you're having a hard time paying attention? And there were times where we said that in a constructive way. But there are other times where some of the stress of our daily life came into that conversation. We didn't realize it at the time. No one does. That's not how life works. But as a parent, if your stress doesn't get dealt with in a healthy way, well, it'll come out in an unhealthy way, won't it? And I think we can see that in all of our lives. We all have stress in our lives. It's part of everyday life. As you go through the world, it's impossible to walk through the mud puddles of life without getting your shoes dirty. That happens to all of us. So we would be in denial to say, oh, we don't have any stress. We don't have to worry about that in our home. No, the better thing is to say, yes, I do have stress. I have to pay the bills. I have to get the kids to school. I have all of these things that parents have. Or if you're a student, to say, yes, I have to get good grades. I have to get up on time. I have to keep my room clean. I have to do my chores. I have to be respectful at school. These are the responsibilities that come with everyday life. Guess what? They also produce some stress. And the thing about stress is if you deny it, it just builds up and builds up and builds up. And if you leave it alone, pretend it isn't even there, it'll just stay inside of you until it bursts forth at the wrong time. It'll burst forth when you have your hair let down, so to speak, which what I mean by that is when you're in your home and you're just chilling out. someone will say something and you'll snap and you'll hurt them. I want to ask you tonight to look into your own hearts and into your own situations that you've gone through as a student and really ask yourself, where is the stress and anxiety of your life coming from? I mean, I really would ask you to pick up a notepad or your tablet or phone and actually jot down a few little notes as you're listening tonight. Where is my stress coming from? You know, a lot of students, they think immediately of those bullies at their school or those kids who annoy them at school or those teachers. But they need to stop and think about what's actually happening in the home environment. What I tell students is that they need to realize that other people's anxiety doesn't have to be their anxiety. Are you here? Are you listening tonight? Like, don't miss that. If tonight's session is about anything, let it be about this, that other people's stress doesn't have to be your stress. In fact, when you get bullied and there's haters out there and they're hating on you, what you have to realize is you have to say, you know what? That's more about them. It's more about them. It says so much more about them than it does about me. They might be saying, I'm a geek, or I'm a nerd, or I'm a nobody, or I'm worthless. I've heard all those things in my own life over the years. But when I made the breakthrough as a student was when I made that realization that their hate doesn't have to be my hate. And although they might try to put baggage into my life, I can refuse to carry it. So what I do, I take that baggage and that stress and that dirt and all that stuff and that grime of life, and I breathe it out. I actually do some deep breathing techniques even sometimes to calm my heart down. If I am ever really getting my, you know, if someone else is really eating my lunch, I'll take some deep breaths. We've been teaching our kids to do this, my wife and I, to teaching our kids, hey, look, their anxiety doesn't have to be your anxiety. Their bad day doesn't have to be your bad day. We've been encouraging our kids who are only 9 years old, 7 years old, and our twin daughters who are 5, that even at those young ages, they can stop, take a deep breath, and breathe out that anxiousness. You know, you have power over your emotions. A lot of people think that emotions just come and go. And to the passive observer of life, emotions do come and go. You know, it's not like you can just flip the switch on and off for your different emotions. But what you can do is when you're getting into that funk of bullying, of depression, of anxiety and stress, you can stop, pause, and do some deep breathing techniques. You know, for a lot of kids, that's another time where you can go get help from that trusted adult. For me as a student, I had a particular youth leader of mine who I connected with. You know the story from my book, the story from the Victim Proof book about my teacher, Mrs. Burdick. Well, one story that didn't make it in the book was the story of a volunteer youth leader who worked for this nonprofit youth organization. I'd go to it every Wednesday night. It was called the Lakewood Youth Center. And I had one adult there who breathed life into me. And what I mean is they always encouraged me. This guy, his name was Jim. And Jim always lifted me up and he praised the positive things in my life. And even though there were a lot of sort of geeky kids that came to this place, I realized it didn't matter what other people said about me. It didn't matter. That was more about them, more about their bad day. And their bad day didn't have to become my bad day. So I want to encourage you students tonight, if you're going through any of that kind of stuff in your life and it's a hard time for you, to promise me that you'll get help from that adult. For me, that made all the difference. And as you know, with my teacher and with my mentors in my life, I made a huge change that changed everything in my life. Where would I be today if I didn't make that change? I don't even want to think about it because it's so scary. I mean, it's not even worth thinking about. But my life made a clear change over time when I started becoming victim-proof. And I will tell you this. This is a really cool thing that happened about a month ago. Month ago or so, maybe 5 or 6 weeks ago, I got a message from an old friend from high school. And she says, Tom, I'm so excited to reconnect. I see here all the cool things you're doing, all of these schools that you're speaking at. I'm so proud of you. You were such a positive influence in high school. And I read that and I thought, you know, what? Maybe at the end of high school, but I thought, did she even know me at the, you know, beginning of high school? At the beginning of high school, I was a geek. I was a nerd. I was a victim. I carried around other people's stress. Every time I got bullied, I felt like a victim. And you know from my book, How I Got Help. Well, I thought, how did this girl think I was such a positive kid at my school? Because what would happen with me is I would let that stress back out into the school by acting out and by being a class clown. And sometimes even by hurting other people with these little sarcastic comments I made. Sometimes even bullying other kids without realizing it. And I thought, how did she think I was such a great influence? Well, I thought back on it, and then it finally dawned on me. This girl from high school, the reason she remembered that is because she didn't come to our school until she was a senior. And so she saw me after I met my teacher, Mrs. Burdick, after I went to that counseling program, and after I made the change. She only knew the after story, not the before story. Now, you guys, you might tonight be in the middle of your before story. You know, you're in the middle of the toughest story of your life right now. And you're thinking, you might feel like anyway, that the walls are caving in and your train's going off the tracks or whatever metaphor you want to use. But I want to promise you this. After middle and high school are done, many, many, many of those social things of who's important and who is more popular and who has more status, you know, a lot of those, a lot of that social hierarchy that is so prevalent in high school, guess what happens? The day after graduation, it just evaporates and goes away. You know, you have so much of your life ahead of you, so many great years ahead of you to be the change. You can start that today, and I really hope you will. Tonight's session is a little short here. We only have a few other questions that have come in. And I really just want to ask you tonight, when we close, we're going to wrap up the session in just a minute. When we do, I want to ask you to write down your number three, your top three stresses, anxieties, and haters in your life. These could be people, places, events, circumstances. Write down those top three things that are getting at you. And then I want to encourage you to take that paper and find a creative way to destroy it. When you destroy it, I don't want you to destroy it and create more anxiety for your life. I want you to actually breathe a sigh of relief and say, you know what? That anxiety doesn't have to be my anxiety anymore. Isn't it cool to know that other people might come and go, but it's really up to all of us to become victim-proof from the inside out. Each of us has the responsibility to be a healthy person on the inside of our hearts and minds. And that means we don't have to carry the baggage of other people anymore. It's not worth it. Man, do not carry the baggage of other people. As you look to the rest of this year, refuse to carry the hate of the haters in your life. And that's how you will become victim-proof. You guys, it's been a really cool session tonight. We did have a couple of other questions that came in, but I tried to lump those into some of the stuff we talked about with the anxiety and the stress. If you have more questions, shoot them off to me. I know we have a lot of people viewing on our victimproof.org website, and so you're not logged into the Google Hangout. What you guys can do if you're not logged into the Google Hangout is you can actually email your questions to me, email them to admin@victimproof.org. And those will come, and I'll be able to screen through those, lump some of them together, and put them together for our next Google Hangout webcast. So look, make it a great week this week. I know you guys will if you choose to become victim-proof. So be the change this week, guys, and thanks for hanging on the call tonight. You guys are awesome.